year that we've had, what does the IPO market look like in 2019?
Well, I think, just as you said, if we've got anywhere from a flat to up market, you're going to have a strong IPO year.
Yeah.
There's just no question. Some of the big names are really going to come out this time. I also think that you're going to see some emerging things around autonomous and cyber that are going to accelerate, potentially becoming unicorns themselves in the next year or so.
But are we going to be in a flat to up market if all these tech stocks are still down?
You know, it's an interesting question. I guess it's all relative to expectations. I think relative to a long-term period, yeah. And I think people are not necessarily looking to this year. They're trying to forecast a couple years out, is it going to be worse? It's a gamble, whichever way you're going to do it. But I think in terms of the broad market, people feel like this is going to be as good a time to do it as any.
So Uber, Lyft, Airbnb, are those the ones you're watching?
Yeah, absolutely. No question about that. Those are the big names. But I think you're also going to see some acceleration of a bunch of mid-market players to try and get ready before the end of 2019.
In what particular areas?
Mostly cyber. And unfortunately, some of them are our clients, so I won't say them by name. But I think cyber is the one thing that's interesting because everybody talks about the growth plays. But cyber as a defensive play, I mean, if you don't have good cyber capability, frankly, you get picked up early stage in a lot of the cyber capabilities. So that's one of the reasons we're seeing so much growth in cyber.
What are the chances that all three of those companies, Uber, Lyft, and Airbnb, do pull the plug?
You know, it's an interesting question. I think the likelihood is it's going to be as a group.
Why?
One way or the other. Because I think they're all going to be looking at market conditions that look at, you know, similar views as to what the market conditions are going to be like. If market conditions are good for one, all of them have good business models.
Right.
Right? So if the market's really, really down, though, I think they may be want to push.
So then what's your outlook for valuation?
Well, valuations are high, right? But I think, you know, it reminds me a little bit of the go-go late 90s. But I think it's very different this time, is the business models were very speculative in the late 90s. You were kind of rolling the dice on a lot of these things. Some people were rolling the dice on whether the internet would even work. Now business models prove out really fast. And none of these companies is in a position where people don't think that they're going to be survivors. So as businesses, it's quality. Now the valuation thing is, I think that's a lot of other people need to speculate on that. But the long-term health of these things, I'm a long-term believer in the global economy and the U.S. economy. If you're going to jump in now, maybe it won't be a giant supernormal return for 3 years, but over the long term, it's going to be really good for people.
Well, I wonder if we're seeing a little bit of air come out of a bubble right now.
Yeah, I definitely think you are, and I actually think it's healthy. I think, yeah, the fact is that there is a limit to how much growth there is forever.
So are we in a bubble then?
You know, it's tough to call it a bubble in my opinion. Yeah. I think it's probably an extended correction. I think it's very healthy to go ahead and make sure that the old irrational exuberance doesn't come back. I think this is probably a little bit of rational exuberance with the occasional irrational thrown in.
What sectors are more ripe for M&A than public offerings?
In terms of within tech,
yeah,
or then, okay, in M&A, I'll go back to the cyber thing. Actually, I think people are trying to scale cyber, but the fact is they get picked up really early.
Mm.
It's really about algorithms. Some of the other big plays you've seen this year are really more about capability and things like collaboration and experience. If you saw SAP's Qualtrics acquisition,
right, we're going to talk
that's all about experience. If you look at the collaboration with GitHub, if you look at the collaboration with Red Hat, those things are not about feature function. So I think you're going to see big M&A continue like that, by the way, no matter what the market, because there's a lot of cash out there. So when it comes to the M&A thing, a down market might actually make the M&A market even more attractive.
Last year this time we were talking all about crypto and ICOs, which have really calmed down. What does that market look like in 2019?
So let's talk about blockchain. First of all, crypto, I think there's a couple of dominant ones. They may or may not survive. I think it's been a very important beta for blockchain overall, is what can you use blockchain for.
So you think even some of the dominant coins won't survive?
Well, we've already seen a number of them go down to, you know, absolute bottom valuation since they started. So, but there's, you know, the whole point of Bitcoin, et cetera, is that you create something that has a limit. But if you keep introducing more and more ICOs, that gets past the whole limit idea. So there's going to be some survivors. There's going to be a lot that don't survive. But the thing that's probably missing is this quiet revolution of blockchain using it for other purposes. InsureWave in the insurance industry, where you're actually dynamically repricing insurance for ocean freight. It's not exciting, but it's billions and billions of dollars of value to the industry by using blockchain for things like that, or royalties and rights management like Microsoft is doing across the industry to actually use artificial intelligence and blockchain to manage royalties and rights management, pretty important in your business. And so there's a lot of that that's not discussed, where there's a heck of a lot of value to be gained in the industry.
There's a theme of this Techonomy conference is one of them is responsible growing. And there's a lot of concerns about regulation. There's a lot of concerns about lack of transparency. How much do you think that'll hold the sector back?
You know, I listened to your previous speaker, and I think it's not just a great question. It's something we've all got to be on top of. And I don't think we want to leave it to just the regulators.
Yep.
I think this is something that those of us in whatever role we play in the industry need to get on top of. I think in particular, you're going to see some questions. We've talked about privacy. We've talked about the, oh my God, AI is going to eat my brain. Those are probably getting more coverage in some ways that they're already being acted upon in terms of ethical use of AI and things like that. But what I don't think is getting enough coverage is how fast tech changes things. Mm. So take the trucking industry where you've got 3.4 million just in the US truckers, nearly another 5 million people who work related to trucking, and then an entire industry of roadside restaurants and things that depend on truckers. That's nearly 10 million voters. And if autonomous, when it comes, goes really fast in the trucking, if we as an industry and a public partner partnership don't have a plan on how to deal with those individuals in a rapid change, we're going to have another controversy on the ethical use of technology. And I think, you know, sometimes disrupted becomes disenfranchised, and I think we all have a duty to kind of work together on that as a collective community.